going down this road and feeling bad. I'm going down this road and feeling bad. I'm going down this road and feeling bad, bad, bad. And I ain't gonna be treated this way.
Okay, everybody, and welcome back to another episode of Porkins Policy Radio. As always, I am your host, Pierce Redman, and you can find this podcast and every other podcast free for download by going to porkinspolicyreview.wordpress.com. Well, today we have the great pleasure of being joined once again by our good friend Danny Benavides, who is, of course, the contributing editor to tracesofreality.com and is also the co-host alongside Guillermo Jimenez of TOR Radio. And faithful listeners will know that Danny was on this podcast a little while ago on episode 23. So, Danny Benavides, thank you so much for joining us again.
Thanks for inviting me, Pierce. It's a pleasure.
Excellent. Well, so I've invited Danny on today to discuss mainly the mass kidnapping or mass disappearance of 43 students, which took place a few months ago in September in Iguala, which is a city in Guerrero State in Mexico, which is in southern Mexico, very near, in fact, a bordering state to Michoacan, which me and Danny spoke about at length in our last podcast. But we wanted to discuss this disappearance of these students, what this means in the sort of broader context of what we're seeing in the past few years taking place in Mexico. There has been a sort of reorganization of the narco chessboard going on. And what is happening in Iguala is very much indicative of what is going on all over. So for anyone who is a little unaware or hasn't been following this story at all, as I said, on September 26th of this year, police, on the orders of either the mayor of Iguala or even perhaps his wife, ambushed a bus carrying more than 43 students, and shot up the bus, killing six, wounding 25, and then they absconded with 43 students who were from a rural area just outside of Iguala. And the students were there, in fact, to commemorate the 1968 mass student protest, which resulted in the deaths of hundreds of students. Now, the police, as I said, kidnapped these students and then handed them over to Guerreros Unidos, which is a fairly new drug cartel which operates within that area. And, you know, the sort of story as to what happened to these students afterwards is, there's a lot of conflicting reports as to what happened. Some saying that they were tortured and then burned, that they were, buried, all sorts of things like that. But essentially, these students are disappeared. No one knows where their bodies are. No one knows if they're alive or if they're not. So, Danny, before we get into some of the specifics of this case, because there are some really interesting connections between all sorts of different characters involved in this, do you want to maybe flesh out this story a little bit and update us on any kind of new developments that are going on? For instance, I know that the remains of one of the students has officially been recognized that he was in fact one of these students. But Danny, what really happened in Iguala back in September?
Well, Pierce, that's the million-dollar question, and I'm not sure I actually have the answer. There's since this occurred, you mentioned September 26, this kidnapping and of course there were murders involved here. This took place over the late night of September the 26th and the early morning of the 27th. And for that entire weekend, this entire ordeal was, number one, it wasn't reported in the mass media until the following week. And in the weekend that this all occurred, there were numerous stories coming out from witnesses there in Iguala. There were stories coming out from the Mexican government starting to sort of build or construct the official story, as it were. So it's all sort of murky, and even to this day, there's a lot of misinformation or disinformation that I think has kind of contributed to distracting from some very crucial aspects of this story that I think point to a larger conspiracy, I guess. That's a bad word sometimes. That really is what occurred here. In Iguala, initially, the night that this happened, and actually I think Borderland Beat was one of the first outlets that I follow anyways among all my feeds that had anything about this at all. And at the time, the shootings and the subsequent kidnappings that occurred on September the 26th, it was reported as just another among about a half a dozen cases of narco violence that had occurred in the southwestern states in Mexico. Like you mentioned, the last time you and I spoke, we talked a lot about Michoacan, the autodefensas movement that arose out of some of the criminal organizations that had been operating in that state. And I think part of the reason we're talking about Iguala now is because of the Mexican government, and particularly the federal government's attempts to stifle the autodefensas movement, these self-defense groups that have grown up, not just there in Michoacán and Guerrero, but there's also autodefensas movements in other states in Mexico. So yeah, the 26th, there was initially, there was actually three buses. Not all of them contained these students, these Ayotzinapa students. They're from a, like you mentioned, it's a rural teacher's college. Basically, to qualify for enrollment in this school, you either have to be, basically, you have to be born a peasant. Either your parents are farmers, or you grew up in a rural area of minimal economic means. And so for that reason, among others, we can sort of start to better understand why it was that these students were targeted. So yeah, there was that initial shootout. At first, it was reported as a possible confrontation between criminal gangs, but in the days that followed that weekend, there started to come out stories pointing to the fact that the municipal police had in fact carried out this mass kidnapping, and during this kidnapping, late night the 26th, early morning the 27th, like you said, there were at least six individuals killed. I believe there were three students, there were three soccer players that were also among the total of three buses that were quote-unquote commandeered by the rural teachers college students. And then in addition, I believe there was a young female that was also killed as the shootouts unfolded, and a taxi driver, if I'm not mistaken. So I believe there's 6 to 8 that were killed that evening. And then the following day is when they discovered the body of Julio Cesar Mondragon. He was one of the Ayotzinapa students, and his body was the one that was found with where his face had been peeled off, and his eyes were gouged out. Very brutal method of killing somebody. And coincidentally, there's been another killing in the in this same area. This other killing actually occurred in Michoacán, but there was a young nursing student just discovered, I think about 2 weeks ago, that was killed in similar fashion. She was shot, and her body was also found with a peeled face and other marks kind of hinting to either torture or some kind of a sadistic way of eliminating somebody. So once that the pictures of Mondragon's body began to circulate through social media, and a few press outlets in Mexico also republished and wrote about his killing, and it started to kind of, the story, or at least what we know about this story, started to kind of come together in the aftermath of the disappearance of these 43 students. And of course, initially, when this first occurred that weekend, there were reports of anywhere between 57 or 58 students that had gone missing, and several of them had basically just scattered when the municipal police that were involved in this kidnapping started firing upon these buses. These students started running every which direction. And from what I've been able to ascertain was that Mondragon, who found himself dispatched in the most gruesome fashion one could imagine, was that he was actually trying to run towards the gunfire to better see who was attacking them or for what reasons. And people believe that that's why he was killed in such fashion, essentially to, and I suppose like a lot of narco murders in Mexico, his death was an example. You know, this is what happens if you try to stop us or get in the way, obstruct, what have you. And so, yeah, there was in the days following this mass disappearance, some of the students that were missing that weekend started to contact their families, their friends, classmates to let them know that they had basically just fled the scene when all the gunfire erupted. And so in the days following, that number of 57 to 58 sort of narrowed down to the infamous or famous, depending on how you're looking at it, 43 students that have gone missing, and has basically sparked this gigantic social movement, this gigantic protest movement in Mexico. But there's a lot more details we can get back into. Certainly, you know, if you've got something on your mind, go ahead and toss me questions and we'll try to make sense of all this.
Mm. Well, yeah, absolutely. I mean, I what I found particularly fascinating about this story, one is the reason that why this of everything has, you know, sort of taken off. Obviously, crimes such as this, while they are pretty spectacular in terms of how many people have, you know, essentially disappeared. It is interesting that you know, and I'm sure that there are a variety of reasons for this, that Iguala and this whole thing has sort of sparked a much larger debate going on in Mexico. As you said, I mean, there are protests going on. You know, this is very big, and even more so than that. You know, aside from the mainstream media actually paying attention and caring about something as horrific as this, there has been quite a bit of focus on the mayor and his wife. And the mayor of Iguala is Jose Luis Abarca, and his wife's name is Maria Pineda Villa. Now, both of these characters have a long history in Guerrero, and especially in the city of Iguala. Interestingly enough, the mayor was involved in a similar incident to this, which happened, I believe it was in May, during a miner strike that was going on in Iguala and in Guerrero in general. There is quite a lot of gold, zinc, copper, silver, all sorts of things, and it is extremely cheap to go there and mine. And there are massive, you know, multinational corporations, including the biggest one is a Canadian mining company that operates there. Anyway, these miners were protesting, you know, all sorts of different grievances, and the mayor, Abarca, actually ordered that the protest leaders be abducted and killed. And according to several reports, one which I read on Borderland Beat, and this was actually going by some people that had escaped this abduction, the mayor was actually there in person, and he himself took part in beating and torturing the protest leader of this, whose name is Arturo Hernandez Cordona. So, you know, if the listeners want to, you know, check out that story, it's very interesting. But Danny, let's get into some of these specifics about the mayor and his wife and their connection to this cartel known as Guerreros Unidos, which I actually was not that familiar with at first. And obviously there are, you know, the situation in Mexico is very complex, but this was a cartel unlike La Familia or Los Zetas or some of the big ones. This is one I had not heard of. So let's get into some of the specifics of this, because as I said in the beginning, this is really a microcosm of what we're seeing going on in Mexico vis-a-vis the relationship between cartels and the state. So let's get into a little bit of the history of this. And I know that Guerreros Unidos was formed sometime in 2011. They were originally aligned with La Familia, and then that ended in 2012. When they placed 10 heads outside of a slaughterhouse in another town in Guerrero with a message that said, "This will happen to all those who support La Familia Michoacan. Sincerely, Guerreros Unidos." But what is the connection between this cartel and the mayor and his wife?
Well, yeah, that's you raise a very good point about the minor incident that occurred back in May of 2013. This occurred near Taxco, which is not too far from Iguala, actually. Some of the rural miners there had gone on strike to protest what they viewed as poor working conditions and exploitation by Grupo Mexico, which is one of the consortiums that does some of the mining there. And actually, the mayor and his wife really came into a lot of money in the gold and silver business. Mm. Now, while I'm sure many listeners are pro-precious metals, as I'm sure you are and I am, you know, the way that Abarca and his wife were able to amass their riches is very curious, to put it nicely. So briefly, to go back to the minor incident, there was, you know, protesters that had complained, that had been complaining since he was elected, about Jose Luis Abarca and his wife Maria de los Angeles Pineda Villa. And there was talk from the first day these two were in office that they had connections to organized crime and drug cartels. And with everything that's occurred, this has pretty much been proven. The federal government in Mexico is still trying to me, it sounds like they're trying to build a case to minimize the fallout from this incident, this mass disappearance. But yeah, so during that protest, it's been reported that Abarca himself had executed that miner, like you said, the leader of this one demonstration that had occurred. And interestingly, while Abarca has been fingered as you know, one of the culprits and certainly one of the hired guns in this state in Guerrero, it's suggested and suspected that his wife is really the one pulling a lot of the strings. Mm. And this is certainly worth considering given the fact of where some of her familial relations lie. I know, you know, Guillermo and I talked a little bit about this in the last TOR podcast we did. And, you know, anyone that wants a little bit more details can check that out. But certainly one thing to make note of is the mayor's wife has, I think she's got five brothers and sisters. Among them are three notable characters. One of them is Alberto Pineda Villa. He's known as El Borrador, which would be the eraser. He was a hitman and an operative of Arturo Beltran Leyva, of the Beltran Leyva cartel. and in addition, there's Salomon Pineda, who's also known as El Molon or El Salo. He is reported to be a boss of the Guerreros Unidos gang or cartel. And interestingly, he was arrested a few years back, I believe, but quietly released. we can get into that a little bit just to discuss the curious way that he was able to, you know, get his release from prison. And then in addition, there's another brother of the mayor's wife, Mario Pineda Villa. He's known as El MP or El MP for his initials. And he was also an operative of the Beltran Leyva cartel. So it's interesting that you mentioned that, you know, the idea that Guerreros Unidos is not as well known as some of the larger cartels. And part of the reason is, and that's why I say drug gang or cartel, they're a little smaller. And nowadays, you know, in the past several years, Peña Nieto can count one thing as, I guess, as a positive, is that he's taken out a lot of the larger, the big time capos, the leaders of several significant criminal organizations in Mexico. But in doing so, what he's done is eliminated heads of organizations and just caused the remaining operatives. Because, of course, if you're working for a cartel and your boss is captured or killed, you don't just suddenly say, oh, well, I better give up my life of crime and find gainful employment. What they do instead is they splinter into smaller cartels or gangs and factions, and they seek employment with other trafficking organizations, as they were, and that's what's pretty much happened with Guerreros Unidos. Now, initially, some of the members or the founders of this gang, this cartel, were part of a sort of an armed wing of La Familia Michoacana. But as I just mentioned, some of the individuals also involved in the, I guess, high-ranking members of this gang, this cartel, were also formerly with the Beltran Leyva cartel. And a few years before, were actually working almost in kind of like the way you think that a contractor would work for the government in Iraq or Syria or Afghanistan or what have you. These gangs were basically working for the Sinaloa cartel. So some of the members of Guerreros Unidos actually began trafficking and doing murders for hire back in around 2000. And in 2002 is when some of these guys, particularly two of the brothers of Abarca's wife, the mayor's wife, were also working for the Sinaloa cartel. And they started doing that in around 2002. They worked for the Sinaloa cartel for a few years up until the split between Beltran Leyva and the Sinaloa cartel. There was some bad blood. And I guess it's interesting I use the word blood because these two cartels do have ties as far as family goes. There's a lot of marrying with sisters and brothers of different cartels, significant people within the organizational structure. And so you've got this curious combination, I guess, of forces here. But once the Beltran Leyva cartel and the Sinaloa cartel started to part ways, and of course they've got pretty much there they had a vendetta with each other back then. You saw some of these guys go over to the Beltran Leyva cartel, specifically because they already had sort of a personal rapport with Arturo Beltran Leyva. He's now deceased. He was killed in a raid with Mexican Marines. But and of course, in the aftermath of Arturo's killing, you had these guys split off and formed their own cartel, which ended up evolving into the Guerreros Unidos. Mm. So you've got a very, and this is emblematic of the way cartels and gangs in Mexico are restructuring these days. And we'll get into the narco chessboard in a moment, but it's certainly worth mentioning these interesting connections. You know, for instance, not only is the mayor's wife herself connected through blood with organized crime, but the governor of Guerrero himself, Angel Aguirre Rivero, he's actually a cousin of a man named Victor Hugo Aguirre Garzol, who is one of the founders of another small drug gang slash cartel known as the Cartel Independiente de Acapulco, which is basically the independent cartel. And interestingly enough, this governor of Guerrero also had among his close confidants another man also with the name of Victor, Victor Jorge Leon Maldonado. He was a deputy attorney for SAIDO. It's the special investigation unit of the Mexican government that basically conducts investigations of organized crime and people connected within these groups. But this gentleman, Leon Maldonado, was actually involved pretty heavily with the capture and the subsequent release of El Molon, the brother of the mayor's wife, El Salo El Molon. So it's interesting to see how all of this works. Not only do cartels nowadays form this kind of a logistical relationship with politicians and bureaucrats and people within positions of power who can kind of provide that protection, that kind of layer of impunity where all of this narco violence flourishes. So this is very much a small, a microcosm, I suppose, of the way cartels and organized crime operate in Mexico. You know, there's a lot of overlooking of, in many cases anyways, overlooking of the fact that that these gangs could never get away with the sort of stuff they get away with without the consent, the approval, the approbation, the financial support of politicians in Mexico. And yeah, so this is all, you know, it becomes a very tangled web when you start looking at all these people that are involved. And certainly even this gentleman I just mentioned, the deputy attorney of Mexico's organized crime investigation unit, his efforts and his, I guess if you want to look at it from a non-conspiratorial perspective, his failure to keep El Molon in prison was never never stopped, never questioned or anything by Mexico's Attorney General, Jesus Murillo Caram, who of course is the one that came out in the aftermath of this mass kidnapping to provide the press conference and the statements from Los Pinos, from the Mexican federal government, sort of laying out the official narrative of this story. And so, yeah, Murillo Caram basically did nothing to ensure that justice was to be served in this case. And that's pretty much been the case since then, is, you know, just the way people can think of Eric Holder in the United States sort of covering up for Barack Obama and the mm-hmm. things that the White House is doing. That's exactly the role that Murillo Caram is playing in Mexico. But yeah, there's a lot to go back to. If I overlooked any of your questions, please, you know.
That's all excellent. I mean, as we said, you know, at the beginning of this really is a microcosm. What is happening in Iguala is you know, this is going on all over. And as you can see in just this one particular case, the familial connections, the political connections, these are very, very complicated and this, you know, for a reason. And I'll just add one more to that whole thing. Pineda Villa's mother, she actually, and I'm sure you saw this, Danny, but she was captured or taken by some group. I'm not sure if this was the government or the police, and she was interrogated on camera. And we'll provide the links to some articles on this. But in that, you know, she reveals, of course, that her daughter is very well connected with Guerreros Unidos and all these other things. But one of the other things is that she's actually the relative of a deputy secretary in the Mexican Marines. And, you know, more or less insinuates that, again, this is how this power couple in Iguala was able to sort of get away with so much stuff. I mean, so now we've got the military also involved in this on some level as well, protecting these individuals. But I'd like to go back a little bit to the sort of reshuffling of the chessboard, you know, the narco chessboard, because it really is interesting. And I wonder, Danny, does this have any sort of, you know, you mentioned Peña Nieto getting rid of the sort of big, you know, the head capos of these large cartels. I mean, is this partly due to the capture of El Chapo? You know, is this what Nieto wants to do? I mean, is this sort of part of his plan? Because again, it seems if people have been paying attention, even just in the last few months, there has been this explosion of smaller gangs and cartels that have been moving in. We've got Los Rojos is another one, which is sort of within that area as well. You mentioned the independent cartel. There is the cartel in Jalisco. There are just so many now. How are we going to see this? Are we going to see them sort of forming into larger conglomerate cartels? Or is this sort of part of the whole game, is to just kind of, you know, reshuffle the whole deck, move around all the pieces, and then just kind of see what happens? So I'd love to sort of get your take on that, Danny.
Yeah, I think primarily the captures, particularly recently, there's been quite a number, and it's almost a curiously, almost amusing pattern we've seen recently of several pretty significant cartel figureheads, at least, that have been captured without a shot being fired, is how it's read often in the English press. And I think for the most part, these arrests have been for show. These are for demonstration only. As of course, Mexico's kind of notorious, not kind of, they are pretty notorious for providing to capos of this sort, sort of a like a 5-star hotel, mm-hmm. Jail sentence, where even though they're in prison, in a maximum security prison, mind you, they still have access to, you know, they can traffic drugs on occasion, they can get cigarettes in there, no problem, whatever they need, whatever they want, conjugal visits with significant others or whoever. You know, so I think for the most part, like the capture of Chapo, the capture of Hector Beltran Leyva, the last brother, the last holdout of that sort of fading cartel, I think these are mostly done for public consumption. It's to sort of, you know, put a little bit of a sugar coating on what, apart from these, you know, instances, is a very bitter and foul tasting, you know, media perception of Mexico. So many times I think these captures are just to help the PR efforts of the Mexican government, particularly when it comes to, you know, Peña Nieto. One of his campaign promises, if you want to call it that, was to bring foreign investment back into Mexico. So I think that's part of it, is to paint a little bit rosier picture of Mexico and to lay out the notion that it's not all bad. But yeah, I think this is responsible for, like you mentioned, the fracturing and the factions of several larger cartels that in the aftermath of Peña Nieto's clampdown on, you know, Mexico had a list of the 37 most wanted cartel heads in Mexico. But I think for the most part, this is all just for show. And this is basically leading to a kind of a new generation of organized crime south of the border, where these gangs and cartels operate a little bit more autonomously. They're decentralized. Mm. And instead, they basically, what's done here is it creates a network, in many cases anyways, of a logistical trafficking organization, where it's easier to traffic throughout particular drug routes in Mexico and into the United States, of course. And these logistical networks are done less in the manner that the Sinaloa Federation had done in the past, and more as kind of a loose organization of smaller groups that operate on their own and don't take orders from anyone high up on the food chain necessarily. And not only are gangs and cartels part of this network that I'm talking about here, but of course, like I mentioned earlier, you know, the politicians play a very important role in providing some of the shield of immunity and impunity that is going on here. And in addition, you have most certainly, glaringly evident in the case of Iguala, you have municipal police, you have state police, federal police, and Mexican military in various capacities, also serving very important functions within this drug trafficking, human trafficking, murder for hire sort of a network that's gone on. Because of course, this is very big business, and money talks in Mexico, and that's certainly the way things have been going for, you know, the better part of the last century. And that's part of the reason why I remain pretty cynical about everything that's unfolded in Mexico thus far. But I am pretty comforted and enthusiastic about the mass protests that have gone on after this newest scandal. And of course, an important thing, you mentioned this earlier, things like this, violent events like this, mass disappearances, mass killings involving organized crime in Mexico occur on a regular basis, even of the magnitude that we're talking about here with the Ayotzinapa students. But the difference this time around, I think, to me, is that number one, this was done to students. There's no, in the past certainly, the Mexican government always tries to paint the picture as if the victims of organized crime are themselves involved in drug trafficking or their informants for a particular cartel or whatever. But in this case, there's no way that anybody can believe
yes.
any such suggestion with these students that have disappeared. And certainly that's part of the reason I think that the government, the federal government in Mexico is trying to build, this narrative. And I think the recent discovery of the bone fragments and I believe a tooth of Alexander Mora, one of the Ayotzinapa students, kind of plays into this a little bit. We'll get into this in just a moment, but before we get that far into the rabbit hole, we'll talk a little bit more about some of the details. Good. I mean, I guess I don't want to monopolize the time here.
Go right ahead.
Cool. I appreciate that, Pierce. The one thing worth mentioning here, well, there's many things, but there's been a lot made of why these students were kidnapped and why this was done to them by the municipal police. So number one, the municipal police in Guerrero has a pretty formal connection in a sense with drug trafficking organizations, Guerreros Unidos and other such cartels. They have, I mean, in this case, we're talking about kind of a trifecta of kind of leadership as far as the order to capture or eliminate these students. It's believed that this came from either the mayor, Abarca, his wife, or the secretary of public security in Iguala. He's basically in charge of the municipal police. His name is Felipe Flores. And Felipe Flores, as far as I'm aware, is still at large. So interesting to keep that in mind. But basically, the municipal police sort of became part of Guerreros Unidos cartel. And it's very similar to the way, for instance, that the municipal police in Michoacán served very vital roles for La Familia Michoacana back when they were at their heyday, their most powerful. And then that part that sort of plays into the fight against the Familia Michoacana by the Mexican military and the Mexican government, and then the subsequent evolving of Familia Michoacana into Los Caballeros Templarios, which are also now in the wane. This is another group, another cartel that in recent months and then over the past couple years has seen many dozens, if not hundreds, of its members arrested, killed, and it looks like at this point Caballeros Templarios is also fading out. But that doesn't mean that narco violence has been eliminated from Michoacán. In fact, quite the contrary. Despite the clampdown on the Templarios, there's still quite a lot of organized crime going on. And in fact, there's now some alliances that have been formed between groups operating in Guerrero, which of course is the neighbor state of Michoacán. So you have a lot of these groups now sort of forming this alliance. And that's part of this narco chessboard, that this movement of very significant chess pieces, as it were. But yeah, there's a whole lot to kind of expand on there. So please, Pierce, go for it.
Well, I mean, you were mentioning just there why these students were in fact targeted, and I think that is an extremely important piece in this story. Because, of course, you mentioned at the very beginning that they had, quote, commandeered a bus. And that this is indeed what the Western mainstream media sort of framed it, that these students were these kind of radical, this radical group, you know, they're extreme leftists or something like that, and that they had, you know, taken over this bus. This is, in fact, a fairly common practice where they live, and it's not as if that they stole this bus or hijacked it. They, in fact, paid the bus company and, you know, drove the buses themselves, I believe. And again, these students were going there to commemorate the 1968 student massacre, which took place in Mexico just before 10 days before the Olympics were due to be there. But according to a couple of reports, it is believed that Pineda Villa, the mayor's wife, in fact, was angry or thought that these students were coming to protest her. And she was giving some speech, and there was going to be a party in her honor. And, you know, if you do like a quick search of her and, you know, charity work, it's all of these pictures of, you know, her looking, you know, very, very nice and in expensive clothes next to, you know, elderly citizens in it, you know, some sort of rundown retirement home that she's allegedly going to, you know, rebuild or something like that. And in fact, it is pretty commonly believed that she was, you know, pissed that these students might wreck her party. So she ordered the police to, you know, intercept them and then take them and then hand them over to a Guerreros Unidos operative or member out on his ranch and to dispose of them. So, I mean, Danny, if you want to pick up on that at all and just kind of, you know, your take on this, because, again, it just goes back to show you how vindictive and how psychopathic these people can be, that the idea that these students might be protesting a party in her name when she obviously is so involved in all of this stuff going on, and that she would essentially disappear these students because of that. So, you know, your take on that, Danny.
Yeah, and that's certainly important. Initially, at least, and this is kind of goes along with the Mexican government's official narrative of what occurred here. Supposedly, these students were in Iguala and in the nearby community, and they were collecting donations among other things, to organize and stage a demonstration. This was not for the demonstration against the mayor's wife. According to some of the students that had survived this ordeal, they in fact had not even planned on protesting the mayor's wife or her event. She's the head of a family development organization in Guerrero, which is so ironic as to be disgusting.
Yes.
But basically the official narrative basically is that they were out there collecting donations. They wanted to protest the mayor's wife's event. It's her second such event with that organization that she heads, and basically it's just a political rally. There's nothing much more to that. But according to reports that I've read, during this event at which Abarca and his wife were having drinks and dancing and having a wonderful time, at some point the wife was informed that some of these students were on their way to the event in order to protest and stage a big demonstration and to basically rain on her parade. And it's been said that upon hearing this information, Maria de Los Angeles had decided or had commanded the municipal police and the Mexican army. There's a military base very close by where all of this occurred, and it's very curious, some of these details. For instance, supposedly, and this is not the official narrative, but supposedly seated beside Maria de Los Angeles Pineda Villa was the head of the 27th Infantry Battalion. There's this military base that is in Iguala. It's about a mile or two away from where this initial kidnapping / shootout occurred. And this leader of this military base is supposedly the one that took the order from the mayor's wife to take care of the students. Supposedly, it's been insinuated that the mayor's wife may not have even necessarily said, go get those students and kill them all. It's supposedly she just told the head of this battalion to take care of the problem, to take care of these students. And so it's believed, my suspicion is that, in fact, the municipal police, after they kidnapped these students, had taken them to this military base in order to be dispatched, whatever means that might mean. Some of these students might still be alive. My suspicion is that they've all been killed. And after being killed, they were disposed of in, I would imagine, several locations to try to minimize the likelihood that all of them would be found. And very interesting. In fact, you know, part of the Mexican government's official narrative is that essentially the municipal police had in fact, according to them, had delivered these 43 Ayotzinapa students to the Guerreros Unidos gang. And then several of the members, two of them that were arrested and then provided confessions on tape, had details, some of the fact that, okay, so some of these students, they were kidnapped. We brought them over here near this garbage dump in a little small town near Iguala called Cocula. And there's a pretty large landfill that is in this area. And according to the Mexican government, this Guerreros Unidos gang had basically marched these students down into the landfill. They shot some of them. They butchered some of them and dismembered them. Others were burned alive, it's been said. But basically, they forced all of these students into this landfill. They basically laid them into this big hole. They threw a bunch of firewood and tires and trash on top of them and burned it. And then after about 12 to 14 hours that the fire had been roaring, they took the remains of this inferno, they bagged it up, and they tossed the remains into the river nearby. However, it's been mentioned, and you can actually check this out if you want. That entire weekend in Iguala and the surrounding area, there was pretty significant rainfall that had occurred. So people have been questioning this story, you know, if in fact it was raining as heavily as it was, how is it that a fire burned for 12 to 14 hours and reduced all of these 43 students to ashes and small bone fragments? So that's part of the reason that I don't buy the official story that's been presented thus far, and I don't really give much credence to the taped confessions of these two Guerreros Unidos members that Murillo Caram presented back on, I believe it was October the 17th, I think, if I'm not mistaken. Or no, excuse me, it might be the 17th. It was October the 17th was when Murillo Caram had his press conference where he laid out the Mexican government's official story. So there's all these kind of curious questions surrounding this event. And thus far, the Mexican government has really dragged its feet, and purposefully so, I think. You know, and part of this all is to sort of stifle or at least put a halt to the allegations of criminal violence and criminal connections with the Mexican government. They're sort of trying to lay this all on the municipal police, but my suspicion is this goes a lot higher than that. I can't quite prove it yet, but I think there's circumstantial evidence to take note of that at least, at minimum, debunks some of the official narratives, details that the Mexican government has laid out thus far. And of course, to go back to the reason why these students, you're right, in the American press, in the English press, they're described as hardcore leftists, they're practically communists, socialists, yes, and all that stuff. And there's a little to that, but not really. I think more importantly than, because of course, you know, the Ayotzinapa students and the normal schools, the escuelas normales, they're activists primarily. They're not, I don't see them as, well, number one, being potent enough to change the Mexican government, but and I don't think they're trying to change, you know, the way the Mexican government is organized or what party is in power or anything like that, whether it's the leftists or the right wing or whatever. More than anything, more significant than some of the quasi, you know, socialistic ideas that some of these Normales students have, I think more importantly is the fact that, number one, they're activists. And I think in Mexico, if you're a narco trafficker, that's unfortunate, and it can be a problem in, you know, in certain cases, but that's not really the primary concern of the Mexican government to eliminate narco traffickers all over the country. I think primarily the enemy of the Mexican government, just like in a lot of places, certainly the United States comes to mind, the enemy of the government there are the activists, the people that make the most noise, that stage the largest demonstrations, that have the most support of the communities in which they demonstrate or in which they live and are active. I think that's primarily what the Mexican government is trying to put a stop to, is these wild activists who want some kind of reform in the Mexican government, whether it be local, state, or federal. I think that's primarily what really set this thing off. Is that basically you're dealing with, you know, and of course the Ayotzinapa students, just like other normal school students, they're part of their education is the activism in being able to stand up for yourself. Because of course, if you can't do that in Mexico, you will be walked all over, and that's certainly the case, you know, almost on a daily basis.
Well, I think that's an excellent segue right now into the sort of activism that we've been seeing going on in Mexico. But and just before we get there, as you were talking before about this, you know, that they're blaming everything on the municipal police and Guerreros Unidos, and as you said, I mean, there are so many odd things going on, like the rain and the presence perhaps of a military official there. And I actually was just thinking, as you were saying, that is really interesting. Again, we have the mayor's wife's mother is connected through a relative to the Mexican Marines. And it does seem as if everything is being forced on to this small cartel and the municipal police. And in fact, there have been several recent arrests other municipal. I know the deputy director for public safety was arrested. In fact, the mayor and his wife have finally been arrested. And just today, before we were recording, Danny, I was on Borderland Beat, and there were two supposed high-ranking members of Guerreros Unidos in Chicago who were arrested. So it does seem as if they are kind of cleaning up shop and perhaps, you know, covering up for, you know, something that might hit a little bit closer to home in terms of, you know, Peña Nieto and his administration and the sort of political octopus that you know, has been created through all of this. So very fascinating. And again, we should really be paying more attention to this because, you know, when they first started investigating and looking at this garbage dump, I know that they found other mass graves that they had originally, the investigators thought, oh, these are the Normalista students, but in fact they were other people. So again, I mean, this is not uncommon, and there are thousands upon thousands of people that are disappeared and then are later found in these giant mass graves. But let's move on a little bit to the sort of activism that we've been seeing in Mexico. And I know that there is a lot going on in the news, and for various reasons, people don't pay attention to what is going on in Mexico. Sadly, I find that it is people living here in the United States that are not, you know, paying attention to what is going on, you know, right next door to us. But we have been seeing, you know, very large-scale protests, especially in Mexico City, with, you know, things like tens of thousands of people pouring into the streets, calling for Peña Nieto to resign. Basically, I mean, just really, these are serious things, you know, whereas instead when, you know, protesters in Ukraine are marching with neo-Nazis, we're meant to think that this is democracy and change and that, you know, those are the only protests that we should care about. Not the ones, you know, going on in Mexico. But, you know, Danny, I was reading a couple different articles on this. And, you know, there are, you know, analysts and other people saying that this could be the beginning of a Mexican spring. And I must confess, I absolutely hate that term. The whole Arab Spring, all of those color revolutions, all of those sort of things have really come to mean, you know, subversion. And right. You know, anytime that someone tacks on, you know, the spring to the end of some sort of protest thing, the same thing with, you know, Occupy Central or Occupy this or Occupy that, what starts off with good intentions is very easily subverted. And I can't imagine a place that, you know, the United States government or at least factions like the CIA, big multinational corporations, all of the major banks, there is so much money to be made off of the drugs trade that, you know, the idea of people throwing out Peña Nieto or something like that, I'm sure that there, you know, there are powers that would not like to see this. But how do you see the protests moving? Because, again, Mexico has not seen protests like this for some time now. And I think that this is actually a positive thing and is something that, you know, the powers that be in Mexico should be worried about. But what is your take on this, Danny?
Well, one quick thing before I get into that. You mentioned the Guerreros Unidos cell that was captured up in Chicago. Mm. I think, you know, I haven't done the research yet, but it's interesting to note Chicago because that's the former governor of Michoacán, Fausto Vallejo Figueroa, he actually fled to Chicago at around the same time as his son was captured on tape with La Tuta, mm-hmm. the leader of the Caballeros Templarios. And so I believe the former governor of Michoacán actually has a home out there. So it's very interesting just to kind of consider the possibility, perhaps, that there's more than just... This is not just a coincidence. I'll put it that way.
Yes.
I believe there's a lot more to this than just he happened to go to Chicago for liver surgery, because I know he is a sickly man. Mm. But then even then, I also kind of question how it is that the former governor of Michoacán was able to get a liver transplant, given the fact that some of the big high-ranking murderers within Caballeros Templarios had among their sources of revenue organ trafficking. Mm. So just interesting little side note there. But as far as the protests go in Mexico, like I mentioned earlier, it is very encouraging. And it really it makes me want to hope for something better. However, I'm just really a cynical person, I think, through and through. Number one, protests and demonstrations similar to this occur fairly regularly in Mexico, certainly with a case like this with the missing 43 Normalista students. But every time there's a protest like this, there's always some kind of a quasi, you know, pseudo reform of some kind. And, you know, hey, it works in the United States. I would imagine it's going to work in Mexico too. But I would imagine Mexicans are less patient or less confident in their government's ability to really engage in any significant reform. So although I don't expect a whole lot from the Peña Nieto administration, it does encourage me a lot to see so many. I mean, this isn't just a few protests here and there with a few thousand people. These were, I mean, not only were there protests worldwide in solidarity, you know, in the United States, in Europe, Australia, in the Middle East, I saw a few protests there, you know, however small. So that's encouraging. And certainly in Mexico, there have been, in Mexico City, for instance, there was some gigantic protests, hundreds of thousands of people basically occupying the town square. And man, I shouldn't have used the word occupy, but that's what they were doing. And you're right. You know, I don't think this is a Mexican spring. This isn't, I don't know if this is a revolution, as it were, or what will come of all of this. But at least it shows that the people there are really tired of all of this, and hence the now infamous or famous hashtag Ya Me Cansé, the infamous last words of the Attorney General of Mexico as he quickly exited the stage during that press conference where he laid out this official story. You know, of course, as soon as he was done speaking, a journalist stood up and began asking some tough questions. His reply was, "Ya me cansé, I'm tired of this," and he walked off the stage. And of course, since then, this has helped to really ignite this gigantic protest movement. So I'm glad to see this is occurring. I don't quite know what will come of it, if anything, but I hope at least it encourages more people, you know, because I don't see the change coming from Los Pinos, from the Mexican capital, as it were, in the federal district. I see more of the positive change coming from the individuals, the people that really care about what's going on, will, I hope, do some of the legwork and the investigation. And, you know, maybe I can contribute in some minuscule, microscopic manner myself, at least with English, with an English-speaking audience. But I hope people kind of start to unravel this narrative that's been proposed by the Attorney General's office in Mexico to kind of really put the blame where it belongs. Like you said, you know, they're trying to sort of stop this at the municipal police and lay out the notion that only they were responsible for what occurred, and it was just, oh, these rogue police officers and whatever. I feel strongly, although I can't prove it, that this goes much higher than just a municipal police, a few bad apples, and a lot higher than just an obscure drug gang in a southwestern Mexican state. This is a lot more substantive than just that. And like we mentioned at the beginning of the conversation, this is a microcosm for how drug trafficking organizations operate in Mexico. And like I mentioned, it's not just that they're so savvy and geniuses when it comes to forming these trafficking routes and this, that, and the other. This is done primarily, or I guess I should say incidentally, with assistance from high-ranking people in political office, with people within law enforcement, and certainly within the military apparatus as well. I think everybody plays a role. In fact, you know, if anyone's curious to read a little bit about how this has played out in the past, Annabelle Hernandez is an awesome journalist based out of Mexico. She has a book that's recently been translated to English called Narcoland. In Spanish, it's called Los Señores del Narco. And she has pretty much an entire chapter devoted to what she calls the suitcase plan. Like, she explains how, for instance, in the past, some of these drug cartels basically fill up suitcases full of cash And these suitcases make the rounds through political office, through key military figures. You'll see, for instance, secretaries of transportation. You'll see people that are involved in the management of highways or checkpoints. You'll see people that are involved with inspections along the coast, like, you know, of course, Guerrero and Michoacán have very lucrative, very important coastal economic sectors. They rely a lot on imports and goods that are received through the seaports there. So, Anabel Hernandez in her book talks a lot about how the suitcase makes the rounds through all of these key positions of power and all the way up to the president's office in Los Pinos, and how every time the suitcase makes a stop, somebody gets a chunk of the money. And that's how all of this is arranged. This is that blanket of immunity and impunity that I mentioned earlier. This is all, and of course, part of the reason why this is such a potent way to get this sort of narco business done is because of the fact that it's so lucrative. You know, if you look at all the economic sectors in Mexico, the drug trafficking trade, even though it's black market and numbers are nebulous at best, it still shows that drug trafficking is one of the, if not the primary economic sector of the entire country of Mexico. You know, billions and billions and billions of dollars every year. And you can't think for a moment that only, for instance, El Chapo or La Tuta, yes, or whatever figurehead is the one that rakes in all of this cash. They make a small cut like everybody else, and all the people that matter that could stop this if they wanted to, they get their cut too. And that's why this continues like year in and year out.
It's not just drugs. I mean, it's things like gold and silver and, you know, the mining sector, timber, all sorts of, there are lots of different, pies for them to get their hands in.
And exactly.
This is sort of a negative and a positive, but I think these big protests, at least in Mexico City, have scared Peña Nieto somewhat, because we're also seeing reports of masked protesters. Oh, surprise, surprise, you know, every time we get, you know, something that might be real, you know, or towards change or something, we get these masked individuals who are setting fire to buildings and smashing windows. And many of the protesters in these were shouting, paid by Peña, infiltrators, provocateurs, no violence. And I even saw that there was this, Peña Nieto was sort of using this as a pretext to attack a lot of the protesters, but there was this, you know, these attempts to burn the door down to the presidential palace. But when people started looking at the video, they believed that they actually saw a Mexican army general in plain clothes amongst the demonstrators. And again, this sort of parallels to the 1968 protest, which I mentioned before, where in fact government snipers shot at police to instigate a huge massacre.
Yeah, exactly. That's right. And not only that, but there are photos and videos circulating through social media that you can find that show, for instance, there's I've seen one photo of like a military, what are they called? An armored personnel carrier, mm-hmm, that's got several military members. I think these are the Mexican army that were on the back of one of these APCs, and they're all dressed in plain clothes, civilian clothes. So it certainly points to the fact that indeed what we saw at these protests, these violent activists, these violent people, masked people, sort of what Americans would characterize as black bloc,
yes,
type of people, the quote-unquote anarchists. these guys were very curiously, these army figures that were photographed curiously had similar clothing as to the protesters that were there throwing Molotov cocktails, trying to instigate some kind of a violent confrontation. And I have no doubt in my mind that that's in fact what occurred. Because, you know, this whole protest is about not just that Peña Nieto's a scumbag or we don't like his politics. This is, we're tired of this narco government and the narco police making victims of all the citizens of Mexico. And I can't imagine that people with legitimate grievances in this case specifically would want to, demonstrate by enacting the same kind of actions that they're deploring. So I certainly think that what we saw there as far as Molotov cocktails and people getting tearing down barricades, trying to burn down the door of the National Palace. Of course, there was the Mexican government building. I believe it was an attorney general building in Chilpancingo, the capital of Guerrero, that was also burned down. Or I shouldn't say burned down, but it was lit on fire. And several vehicles were also incinerated. So I don't know how much of that might have been just protesters getting out of hand as far as Chilpancingo. But I think at the National Palace, what we saw there were provocateurs trying to, denigrate the legitimate protesters there, the people that have real grievances, and at the same time kind of form that casus belli for Peña Nieto to really clamp down on activists. And of course, after this all occurred the following day, English press was all a Twitter about those, you know, black-clad anarchists,
yes.
And this became what the protests were all about. Oh, people just trying to destroy property, and this is the same kind of stuff we saw with Ferguson mm-hmm. here in the United States. You know, a few people being ordered by whom or controlled by whom is unknown, but you've got a few people basically taking actions that are basically used to delegitimize the real protest that's going on there. So yeah, I mean, you're right on point to mention these masked protesters that really sort of turned the direction of the way the protests had been proceeding thus far. You know, like we said, you know, these were protests going on all throughout Mexico. There were, if hundreds, at least many dozens of protests in various cities, municipalities, in various states of Mexico. And these incidences of violence were very few and far between. Nevertheless, it became the headline in the English-speaking press. And that's unfortunate. And I think that also kind of serves to sort of distract from the important thing here, which is the fact that the Mexican government is, at least in certain levels, at certain key positions, working in concert with, drug cartels, organized crime groups, and what have you.
Mm. Absolutely. And I think it's important, you said earlier that this isn't just about having Peña Nieto resign, because, you know, and this is obviously, sitting here in New York, projecting my own views, but I mean, I would assume that, I mean, the general public doesn't trust any of these politicians. These protests aren't about, oh, we need to throw out this bad guy so we can put in another bad guy. Because, of course, right. That is what Peña Nieto's whole campaign was about, that he was, you know, somehow this new leader of the pre-party that ran Mexico for decades under essentially a dictatorship was somehow going to be different from the right-wing pan government. Abarca, the mayor, is part of the so-called leftist opposition, the PRD. So, this isn't really about politicians or political parties. This is, at least on some level represents a much bigger sort of idea that this is about getting rid of this narco control. that has seeped into Mexico, and from there, I mean, you know, all this violence and else, you know, and other things as well. So, you know, again, yeah, this is about a bigger sort of a thing here. But before we wrap this up, Danny, last time we talked, we closed out with an interesting story that I had not heard about, but it was involving Kevin Spacey meeting with Peña Nieto. I doubt he's going to be doing that anytime soon. But you told me about you brought my attention to a really interesting story, which completely flew under the radar here. And you sent me the first sort of report of this, which was in a Spanish news outlet, El Debate, and we'll put the link in, and it is in Spanish, but you know, you can put it in Google Translate, and you'll get the general gist of what they're talking about here. But this is a really fascinating little story, and I think it's good because it brings in the other layer of this whole narco chessboard that we haven't spoken about, and that is the role that the United States plays in all of this. But El Debate in July of this year, July 11th, reported that Mexican Marines were guarding what they believed to be two wounded DEA agents in a hospital in Sinaloa. And in the El Debate article, I mean, they mentioned how mysterious this all was. It was very hush-hush. The reporters couldn't really get any information. Everyone sort of denied that they were DEA. And, you know, it was only sort of rumors that were going on. And, I'm sure anybody here in the West would have just poo-pooed the whole thing. But later in that year, in November, the Wall Street Journal reported on two U.S. Marshals that were wounded in the exact same area and were, in fact, held under armed guard by Mexican Marines in a hospital there. And in what is apparently a very common practice, these U.S. Marshals were in fact dressed up as Mexican Marines, were carrying the Marines, you know, weapons and things like that, and were involved in some sort of confrontation. But Danny, again, really fascinating story. And you know, any kind of bits about this you want to pick apart, or just, I mean, you know, explain it all.
Yeah, well, I don't know if I can explain it, but it is an interesting case study, at least to see, you know, that first story. I remember emailing it to Guillermo way back when I first saw it in my feeds, and I thought, how curious, I wonder what's going on. And I told him, I wonder if it's just bullshit or if this is a real story. And my thoughts at the time were that in fact, certainly I wouldn't be surprised if DEA agents were in fact conducting operations or raids alongside their Mexican counterparts. I mean, this is the way the Mexican military trains. You know, they U.S. Operators will go down to Mexico to teach them, you know, urban warfare and on occasion how to torture people when you're interrogating them, which is a timely topic, I think.
Yes.
But I wasn't surprised to learn that a couple of DEA agents may have been wounded in a shootout with some cartel figures. But it was interesting to see that the Wall Street Journal kind of followed up on this a few months later, and this was the recent article you mentioned. I'm not shocked, but it's curious that this is not just DEA, but in fact there are FBI agents and, like the Wall Street Journal mentions, U.S. Marshals that are participating in these raids. And that itself is not really a shocker. I figured as much, but it's interesting to see that they're actually in uniform. And this kind of goes into what we see in Mexico so often, is that, you know, the term false flag is thrown around a lot, and that's not quite what's going on here, because there's no flag per se for the Mexican Marines or for the Mexican Army or the Mexican Navy or certain police forces or, you know, what have you. You know, there's the counterpart of the CIA in Mexico, CISEN. You know, these groups all are tasked themselves with trying to shut down these traffickers, supposedly. Mm. But it's interesting to see the depth or the scope that these operations actually take place. And interestingly, it's interesting that this happened in Sinaloa because it reminds me of, you know, back in the 80s, in the late 70s and in the early to mid 80s, the CIA was heavily, heavily involved in working with what was back then, before the Sinaloa cartel was the Sinaloa cartel, some of its key figures were part of the Guadalajara cartel. Back then, they were just referred to as the Mexican cartel because they were the primary, the highest, the most connected and important and potent trafficking organization south of the border. But the CIA was working with these guys almost the whole time. And in fact, of course, there's quite a lot that's been written about the abduction and the torture and the murder of DEA agent Enrique Camarena. So it's interesting. And of course, the drug traffickers who took part in the abduction, the torture, and the murder of Quique Camarena were all, or they all carried credentials and uniforms of Mexico's version of the CIA. Before CISEN existed, it was the Agencia Federal de Investigación, I believe it was called. Basically just a federal investigation agency, kind of like the FBI, I suppose. That's what the name would imply. But these were these were the spy masters, if you will, of Mexico. And almost since the inception of this organization, this counterpart of the CIA was there all along. Helping this agency and the traffickers that they were allied with. So it's very interesting to see this story come out of the Wall Street Journal that's talking about American agents in Mexican uniform, carrying Mexican weapons with Mexican credentials. I think this all just helps to further muddy what we learn about Mexico, because unlike other places throughout the world, there's not a lot that's really reported out of Mexico. There's so much that occurs without any written record or any kind of case file that can be FOIA'd and reviewed and all that sort of stuff. So much happens under the radar, away from public scrutiny, that in many cases it's hard to discern, okay, who's legitimately working for the Mexican government, who's just some kind of an informant or a plant of some kind, some kind of infiltrator who's, you know, on the side of the drug cartels. And that's where all of this really gets muddy, and in a way it's like that on purpose. You know, this helps to make it easier for gigantic, you know, criminal killing sprees like we saw in Iguala to continue without any kind of ceasing. And so I think the Wall Street Journal article is very interesting to sort of look at with a little perspective and to sort of re-examine some of the pronouncements of the Mexican government as far as who really is part of a cartel, who's actually working for the Mexican Marines or the Army. And nowadays, of course, you have not just these larger federal agencies, but just like the cartels have sort of decentralized, you have in Mexico now not just this new gendarmerie, the gendarmería, you know, you have also the Fuerza Ciudadana, which is kind of the follow-up to the Fuerzas Rurales that were operating in Michoacán. These were, of course, put together and set out on various tasks by Peña Nieto's personal envoy to Michoacán, Alfredo Castillo. And of course, these supposed community police that are under Alfredo Castillo's command have themselves been linked to organized crime. In fact, some of the heads, the chiefs of these so-called community police forces, which are sort of, you know, this is the Mexican government's attempt to basically flip the Autodefensas movement.
Yes.
You know, they basically crushed the Autodefensas, apart from a few committed Autodefensas groups that are still operating near the coast of Michoacán and a few in Guerrero as well. This is the Mexican government's attempt to shut those down and to supplant instead forces of their own creation. So, you know, before, like I said, there was those fuerzas rurales, the rural police forces in Michoacán. The, you know, there was Papa Pitufo, Papa Smurf. His name is Estanislao Beltrán. He's been linked to another drug gang in Michoacán that's known as Los Viagras, which have thus far sort of formed kind of a loose alliance with some of the criminal organizations that are operating in the neighboring state of Guerrero. Very interesting. And that kind of goes into, like I emailed and tweeted to you, this is part of the crushing, the delegitimization of the Autodefensas movement, the self-defense forces, and kind of this placeholder of these so-called community police, which are in fact just an extension of Peña Nieto's administration, and just another attempt to, like we mentioned earlier, what the Mexican government wants to crush is not the narco traffickers. They want to get rid of all these rabble rousers. You know, you had like in Michoacán, José Mireles, who was, despite the fact that he would say numerous times that he was not the leader of the Autodefensas movement in Michoacán, in many ways he sort of was. He filled that role out of necessity, not because he assumed it or seized it, or that people, you know, elected him to the position, but he was the most capable spokesperson for that kind of loose organization. And of course, he is still in prison, despite thus far there have been two supposed agreements hashed out between José Mireles and Alfredo Castillo to expedite his release from prison. And of course, with each of these instances, Castillo and Peña Nieto's administration have come out to say, oh no, there was never any such agreement, nothing to that effect at all. And of course, Mireles remains in prison to this day. And then in Guerrero, we have another political prisoner, Nestora Salgado. She was a key figurehead of another similar Autodefensas movement in that state known as Upoeg. She was part of the CRAC. There's a few different Autodefensas-style movements that have sprouted in the state of Guerrero. So you have these two sort of community activists, civic leaders, you know, people who are really doing something positive for the society, for the community in their respective states. And of course, they're both in jail under bogus charges. And then all the while, as this all is occurring, keep in mind that La Tuta, the maximum leader of Los Caballeros Templarios, remains at large, despite the fact that practically his entire family is behind bars or at some point has been arrested within the last year or so. The Caballeros Templarios are pretty much dissolved. Just like La Familia Michoacana before, you know, the government kind of cracks down and arrests a bunch of people. They, you know, kill a lot of key cartel heads and plaza bosses and things like that, but the trafficking, the crime, the impunity, the kidnapping, the rapes, the robbery, the extortion, the theft, you name it, it all continues unabated, despite, you know, whatever the Peña Nieto administration claims otherwise. You know, of course, recently Peña Nieto's administration has come out to say, oh, you know, well, this year in 2014, there's been less murders than last year. But, you know, this is cold comfort given the fact that there have been massively more kidnappings. So I think really what less murders means is actually less bodies found, because that's how statistics are made in Mexico. If they don't dig up the body, you know, did it ever really live? Did that person really ever exist? And that's kind of what we're seeing with the Iguala case, because, of course, in the aftermath of the disappearance of these 43 Normalistas, there have been close to 22 mass graves that have been found within this you know, radius of Iguala. And thus far, they've only found the remains of one student that was abducted in this instance. And then, of course, the families of these missing students have come out. You know, they've not been shy about talking about how they don't give any credence at all to what the federal government has said in Mexico as far as its official story and the guys that they've captured, and all they're working real hard to wrap this up. The parents of these missing students don't buy any of that. And in fact, they mentioned that Alexandra Mora, whose bone fragment was confirmed by the Argentinian forensics team that was there in Iguala and the surrounding area, they then sent, of course, these remains over to an Austrian forensics team to do the DNA analysis. So although the bone fragments and the tooth that they located did in fact belong to this missing student, so he is dead. You know, that's the sad part. That's the brutal truth, is that he was killed and his remains have been positively ID'd. However, the bag that contained those remains that were identified was opened when it was received by the forensics teams. So this kind of points to the fact that this was probably planted evidence. And it kind of goes to that, this sneaking suspicion I have that the Mexican government is trying to build or construct this narrative to kind of limit and focus the blame for these horrific crimes on a very small scope of people, very small scope of actors. You got the drug gang, Guerreros Unidos, and the municipal police force that they had on their payroll. But like I mentioned, there's some evidence out there that points to the fact that, in fact, there are many more people involved than Peña Nieto or Murillo Caram or the governor of Guerrero, who's now resigned, Angel Aguirre, would like us to believe.
Oh, no, I think we'll definitely have to return to this case in particular, because it is one of those things that once you start pulling the string on this, suddenly the string gets bigger and bigger and bigger, and suddenly you start to really untangle all of these various connections. You can see how deep this goes, and you can see you know, to what extent this has spread all over. And again, I really do hope that you know, the listeners appreciate how you know, how complex the situation is in Mexico, and you know, what is really going on there. Because again, I mean, Ukraine, Ebola, ISIS, all of these other things, which you know, are important. Unfortunately, Mexico continually, the situation there and the geopolitics of it sort of get, you know, brushed aside. And you know, Danny, you mentioned before, you know, we don't see a lot of FOIA documents coming out on what goes on in Mexico. And what is interesting with that Wall Street Journal article is it kind of opens up the window a little bit, and you start to see what's really going on. Because again, you know, you know, you've got DEA, FBI, US Marshals, Army, all these other things. Where is the CIA in all of this? Because obviously they are intimately involved. But I think we'll wrap it up here, and definitely you know, return to this again in the near future. But Danny, where can the listeners go to listen to you, to read your work, anything like that?
Yeah, thanks. Primarily, you'll see all the work that I do on tracesofreality.com. Guillermo and I try to focus a lot on what's going on south of the border and sort of how it relates or ties into similar issues that we're facing here in the United States. And of course, we want to shine a little bit of a light on everything that occurs in Mexico, at least in terms of the narco-noia. Kind of plug myself there. We try to kind of focus on this because it's so often overlooked in American media, and particularly, you know, there are some good, I suppose you could call them beat reporters that cover Mexico and Latin America at outlets like New York Times, Washington Post, McClatchy, LA Times, Christian Science Monitor, Reuters, all the usual suspects. They have good people that cover what's going on in Mexico, but there's a lot, in many cases, there's so many details that are left unreported or are sort of unexamined. And that's part of this kind of thing that bothers me with professional journalists who kind of try to maintain this semblance of objectivism, or I should say objectivity, not objectivism, objectivity. And I think part of, you know, Guillermo and I are not afraid, you know, we're nobody special. We don't have reputations that we need to uphold in the public eye or anything like that. So we have no qualms about pointing fingers or at least making suggestions. You know, if there are people out there that are really interested and passionate about what's going on in Mexico, at minimum, we can provide you with some of those key links or details to investigate further. And to sort of, and this is not going to be the change in Mexico that is needed to sort of transition away from this narco government that has been in control for decade after decade after decade. That's not going to come undone because they elect this great new leader in Mexico. This is going to have to come from people that care, you know, Mexican citizens, people around the world, journalists that take a strong interest in what's going on south of the border. That's who really matters in kind of fostering the change that's needed, the revolution that we all want to see. So certainly I hope the work that Guillermo and I do at tracesofreality.com will contribute in a small portion to that. You can, of course, follow me on Twitter, which is where I'm probably most active. You can find me at Narconoia. That's N-A-R-C-O-N-O-I-A, like paranoia or terror-noia. But this is specifically relating to the narco field. And I retweet and tweet about other things every now and then. But primarily, I'm focused on what's going on south of the border, the drug war, the kind of whatever's taking place within what's now known as the Constitution Free Zone, you know, along the yes. U.S.-Mexico borderland. All of this is kind of my biggest special interest. And, you know, I always say it, but I really hope I can start to write a little bit more because, you know, I love doing these podcasts because I can kind of get out or express some of these thoughts I'm having, kind of discuss some of the news I've been following. But more than anything, I don't want anyone to perceive me as some kind of an expert because I'm not. I'm a normal guy that just reads the news and I'm following this stuff like everybody else. I think a little bit sometimes of Christoph Herrmann, who you do the New Great Game with. He's, you know, kind of focused on a specific geopolitical area, this, you know, Caucasus region and yes. how this kind of expands out to the influence of the United States and its NATO allies. Guillermo and I kind of want to do a little bit of that in Mexico, kind of find out what's going on south of the border, what's really taking place. And what does the United States have to do, either as far as interests go politically or economically or otherwise, and kind of find where those links come into play? Because, of course, this whole disaster south of the border is all predicated upon the drug war that, you know, with the Wall Street Journal article about American troops in Mexican uniform doing these operations. I'm reminded of the fact that in many cases, in case after case that I've read anyways, what the United States seeks mostly in Mexico is not reform or democracy or any of that garbage that the White House normally flouts, you know, talks about in when the cameras are running. But what the United States wants in Mexico are informants. They want to find key figures within the, you know, black market or organized crime networks that they can kind of co-opt or use to their own advantage. And that's certainly the case with what occurred back in the 80s with the Guadalajara cartel, and then that sort of arose, that sort of created and helped to birth the Sinaloa cartel, the Gulf cartel, the Zetas, and so forth. And I think what's taking place in Mexico now is a little bit of that. We're sort of seeing these, you know, there's a lot of joint operations going on with American military forces and spy agencies and their counterparts south of the border. And the Wall Street Journal article just makes this abundantly clear. And this is all very, this should be, I should say, very worrying to American citizens because, of course, year after year, the U.S. government just throws more money and more money into Mexico trying to supposedly combat narco trafficking and all this kind of stuff. But all the while, what we're actually seeing is the expansion and the growth and the decentralization of all of these groups, that these criminal organizations that the United States pretends that it's trying to put down. Or, you know, and that's I think that's part of, like we talked about earlier, these high profile arrests, you know, El Chapo, there's, you know, Miguel Treviño Morales from the Zetas, Mario Ramirez Treviño from the Gulf cartel. More recently, there's been Vicente Carrillo Fuentes from the Juarez cartel and dozens of other famous and notorious figureheads within Mexico's organized crime. Nevertheless, all the while, the violence gets worse, murders keep climbing, kidnappings go up, extortion goes up. It seems like nobody's immune from the narco violence in Mexico except the drug cartels and the politicians that they co-opt and court.
Mm. Well, and Daniel, I will attest right now that you are making a difference, and I was never as knowledgeable as I am now about what is going on until I started following the work that you and Guillermo keep doing at Traces of Reality. So, you know, hats off to you. Excellent stuff. And let's definitely talk again soon because, as you guys can tell, I'm sure from this podcast, there is so much more to get into and there are so many interesting details. But Danny, thank you so much again for joining us on the podcast and let's talk again soon.
Thanks for the compliments, Pierce. I appreciate it. And I can't wait till we do it again.
Okay, everybody, so that about does it for this episode of Porkins Policy Radio. If you enjoyed this podcast and you'd like to hear some more of my work, then please visit porkinspolicyreview.wordpress.com. And there, of course, you can find all of the episodes free for download, you can stream them off the website, and you can also listen to them on YouTube. And if you want to follow this work, then definitely sign up for the RSS feed. You can follow through email blasts on the website. Always follow me on Twitter at Porkins Policy, and please do subscribe to my YouTube channel, which is youtube.com/1138Porkins. And I must sound like a broken record at the end of these podcasts, but if you really enjoy the work and you want to help support me, then, you know, tell a friend about the show, email it, put it up on your social media. That's the sort of thing that really helps in spreading the word and getting people interested in the kind of work that we do on the podcast. So thank you all again so much for listening to this episode. I'm going to keep it a little short today. There will be some really great interviews and podcasts coming up in the very near future. We will be talking again with Sibel Edmonds and Tom Secker sometime in about mid-January. And next week, we will be doing a really interesting podcast with Aaron Franz and Adam, who, of course, host the amazing show Themes and Memes. So that's another thing to look out for. But anyway, I'm gonna keep it short, and I will leave you there, and I will be talking to you very soon.
Put it there, boy. We'll show these fascists what a couple of hillbillies can do. Well, I'm gonna tell you fascists, you may be surprised. People in this world are getting organized. You're bound to lose, you fascists bound to lose.
All you fascists bound to lose.
I said,
all you fascists bound to lose.
Yes,
all.
Rios, where a million fascists died, you're bound to lose.